वायरलेस हैकिंग मैथडोलॉजी, इन वायरलेस हैकिंग मैथडोलॉजी वी हैव सीन प्रीवियस इन प्रीवियस टाइम लास्ट टाइम वी हैव सीन सम अदर मैथडोलॉजीज लाइक रॉ एक्सेस पॉइंट एंड अदर्स. नाउ देर इज वन मोर ऑप्शन अटैकर कैन डू इज टू क्रिएट द इवल ट्विन. नाउ इवल ट्विन दैट मीन्स अटैकर विल क्रिएट द ट्विन ऑफ द ऑथोराइज वाईफाई नेटवर्क और एक्सेस पॉइंट. दैट मीन्स evil twin means what? A wireless AP that pretend to be the legitimate AP by replicating another network name. Attacker sets up a raw AP outside the corporate perimeter and lures users to sign into a wrong AP. Once associated, users may bypass the enterprise security policies giving attacker access to network data. An evil twin can be configured with the common residential SSID hotspot, SSID or SSID of a company's wireless LAN. Now Wi-Fi is everywhere these days, and so are the all the employees. So they take their laptops to Starbucks, FedEx, like the outside the office or everywhere, and to the airport also. So how do we keep the company data safe? It is very, very difficult to save the company data because they take these PCs, the same PC they have given to work for the organization, they use this PC to outside network and connect them to the outside network also. So whatever the data they have used, they have in those machines, when they connect to these open Wi-Fis or these Wi-Fis where others can also connect easily. So it is very difficult to secure them. Now attacker will do what? Attacker will leave the user to connect to those APs. Like suppose it has been in near the organization building or perimeter, it creates a Wi-Fi name as Starbucks or maybe a McDonald's or something which is very common. Now user will say like, okay, this is like our open Wi-Fi we have about the McDonald's, so we can use this. An attacker user will connect that AP to get the internet connection, and now what? It is a attacker's AP, and what attacker do? Attacker will sniff all the data of that user, and it will sniff all the corporate data also. So how to set up a fake hotspot? We can say evil twin. So you will need a laptop with internet connectivity, 3G or wired connection. So either it is connected to 3G network, 4G network or wired connection, and a mini access point, and a small mini access point you need. Then enable the internet connection sharing in Windows 8 or internet sharing in Mac or Windows 8 or 10, and broadcast your Wi-Fi connection and run a sniffer program to capture the password. So all these operating systems have an option to create a hotspot. So what do you need? We just need these mini wireless LAN, USB LAN or other. Then what? We need an internet connection through the wire or even a 3G dongle or whatever, 3G, 4G dongle. So we will get the internet connection from one side, and then we'll share the internet connection from the other side. And then we can configure that when we share the internet connection, we shared with the name of that AP or the evil twin AP we want to create. For example, like here, attacker is creating the AP with the SSID of Starbucks. It is getting the 3G or Ethernet connection to internet. So computer set as an AP running a sniffer. In this, when these victims will connect this AP, connect this SSID, connect this hotspot in the attacker's machine, so the data of these victims will go through the attacker machine. Now the attacker will do what? It will start the sniffing softwares there, and it will start sniffing the data of those victims. So it will be easy for the attacker, without doing any attack, it can be the main, it can do the man in the middle, and it can do lots of things when it is in the middle, or it will be in man in the middle. Now attacker wants to connect to the network. Now if attacker wants to connect to the AP or the corporate network, then attacker needs to authenticate itself to that access point or that corporate access point or that corporate network, because maybe the corporate network is using the security. Now remember, if the corporate, if the network is not configured with the security, if the wireless network you have configured, people do that, most of the organization do what, for ease of use they just use the wireless network without any security, like open, you just connect and use just like that. So if it is the case, it is very hard to secure because there is no security. Now they feel like we have put the security on all the wired network. They have put firewalls, IDS and everything on that wire network, that which is coming from the internet, WAN connection, they have put everything there. But they have put some hotspot in some corner of the office or some small office corner, and they say, they okay, this is a normal wireless network in this corner, and we are not putting a security, we just wanted to connect it. Now attacker can use that to connect, and it can be into the corporate network directly without coming through the wire network, through the firewalls and IDS. So whenever any organization wants to configure the wireless network, they must have to configure the security so that attackers or anybody cannot connect to the wireless network. Through the wireless network, they cannot connect to the corporate network. Now for the security, they can use this security features. What they can use is WEP, WPA, WPA2. Now if they use even the WEP also, then attacker has to crack the password to connect to the organization network. So what attacker has to do now, has to break the WEP or WPA encryption to break into the wireless network. So first, if there is a security configured, if there is an encryption configured with the WEP encryption, so how the attacker can break it. So first step, this is the step for that. So first step the attacker will do is to start the wireless interface in monitor mode on the specific access point channel. So specific access point channel, it will start the wireless interface on monitor mode. Now for running the interface, wireless interface of the attacker into monitor mode, first it will disconnect that interface from all the other network. First it will disconnect it from the other network, and then what it will do, it will configure the interface to work as a monitor mode. Then what next it will do, it will test the injection capability of the wireless device to the access point. So it will first check that the device is having a capability, having an injection capability or not. And after the test, what it will do, it will use a tool such as AirplayNG to do a fake authentication with the access point. So first it will try to do the fake authentication with using the AirplayNG command, AirplayNG tool. Then start the Wi-Fi sniffing tool such as AeroDump or CanEnable with a BSS ID filter to collect unique IVs. Now because this WEP encryption has a weak point of weak IVs, it is having a problem of weak IVs. So what attacker do in case of breaking the WEP encryption, it has to collect enough IVs, because those IVs do what, these IVs are regenerated and reused, and these IVs are actually created by the WEP encryption key. So if the attacker is able to get or collect enough IVs, then it can break the encryption of WEP or break the password. So first it will try to collect the unique IVs, then start the Wi-Fi packet encryption tools such as in AirplayNG in ARP request reply mode to inject packets. Now it will try to inject the packet so that it will generate more IVs to collect. So it will try to send more IVs and try to collect more IVs, and then run a cracking tool such as CanEnable or AirCrackNG to extract the encryption key from the IVs. Then very simple, it will run the AirCrackNG tool to just extract the password from that collected IVs. Now if the attacker can able to collect enough IVs, or we can say more than 20,000 IVs, then it can be cracked, and it can crack this WEP encryption within 10 seconds. This is how this WEP encryption is weak. It is so weak because these IVs are reused, and it is very short, that it is only 24 bit. So very short period of time it is reused, the IVs are reused. So attacker's task is to just collect enough IVs. then the password will be easily cracked within 10 seconds. Now for doing that, these are the command which attacker will run. First, attacker will run the airmon ng to start the interface into monitor mode. Then it will start running aerodump ng to collect the IVs. So it will do write command and say that IVs, option with IVs, and with the write command it will create this file, and under this capture file it will start capturing the IV. Aerodump to discover SSID on the interface and keep it running, your capture file should contain more than 50,000 IVs to successfully crack the WEP key. Then to generate more IVs, if suppose the IVs are not generating quickly, then what it do? It will do the replay attack. Replay attack, it will do this replay attack number one, and then with the ESSID and the BSSID of the target, and it can use the host MAC address also, the host MAC address which is connected to that AP, and then it will try to send ARP request. This command will do what? It will start sending ARP request to the AP with the host MAC address, and then the AP in reply, it will start sending the reply of the ARP request, and then in that request it will connect the IVs. So to collect more and more IVs, it will use this command replay attack. Then it will do what? After this, it will try air replay number three command. This is to inject the packet using this to generate traffic on the target access point. It can use this also to generate. This is ARP attack. Previous one was to associate your wireless and wireless card with the target access point. It is to associate the target access point, and then this is to generate the more traffic. Now once it has generated more traffic and collected enough IVs, then it will use this aircrack ng tool with that captured IV file. That file name was captured, so it will run on that file, and then what it will get, wait for the aerodump ng to capture more than 50,000 IVs and crack this with this aircrack ng. Now within 10 seconds or within a seconds, it will generate or it will crack the password. It will show you the password, what is the password. Now this password, when you configure WEP password or encryption key, it asks you to configure it in hexadecimal number. So hexadecimal number, that means it will accept only 0 to 9 and then A to F characters. It will not support any other characters. So as you see in this image, the password you will see is what? It is a hexadecimal value. So you just have to remove these colons from between, and that will be the password. So whatever the password will be, it will show it under like this hexadecimal value. So you just have to remove this colon from there, and it will be the password for that WEP. So this is the process for cracking this WEP encryption key, and we'll try this. But nowadays what, nobody uses this WEP because it is very insecure. So everyone uses WPA, but at least I can show you the process. So first we'll go to our Kali Linux, and what we'll check the airmon ng command directly. We will run the command to check whether we have any wireless interface or not. So when we run that command, we will see any wireless interface is there or not. So when I run this command, it shows me this interface name which is supported, and that is what, the wireless interface. We can also run iwconfig command to check the WLAN interface. So we have the Ethernet port, we have local port, and this is the port which is actually wireless. These two ports are not wireless. Now once we know that this is the port and this is the name of that interface adapter, wireless adapter, then what, we will start the monitoring on that interface. Now for starting the monitoring, we will run the command airmon ng start and the name of that interface. Now when we run this, so it will do what, it will convert, it will start or enable monitoring on our wireless interface, and it will create a new logical interface named WLAN 0 mon. So this will be the name for our logical wireless interface which is having enabled monitoring mode. You can see the monitor mode is enabled and the name of the interface is now this. Station mode is this, which is disable the monitor mode, and this is the physical interface. Now once we have monitor interface enabled, now we can run command to capture the IVs. So we will run the arrow dump ng command with the monitor enable interface, so that we can capture the information about the available IPs. Available IP information, that means what is the BSS ID, what is the SSID, what is the ESS ID, what is the cipher they are using, and on which channel they are working, and also the client station which is connected to that SSID, to that AP. Now once we know this information, we can close this again, Control C. Now we can use this information to run the specific arrow dump. Now specific arrow dump, that means again I will run the arrow dump command. Now this time I will use an option, first BSSID, where I will mention the BSSID of that AP which I want to collect the AVs. So I want to collect the AV from, let's say, this SSID. So I will mention the BSSID of that, and then I will mention the hyphen C, and I will mention the channel. So the channel which is this AP is running is 11. So I will mention the channel here. Then next I will mention W command to write, and I will mention the name of the file where I want to write all the captured WEPs, all the captured IVs. For example, I will say WEP crack. So this is the file name where it is going to capture and store all the IVs. And then I will run enter. And now we can see it is start collecting the information, it is start collecting the IVs. And those IVs you can see here as a beacon. Now it is not getting more beacons here because the network is not in use. Now remember the network, how the network is busy, how much the network is busy, that much IVs you will get. Now if the network is not that busy, you will not get that enough IVs quickly, you have to wait. Or else what attacker can do, attacker can run the replay attack, and for running the replay attack it can generate more IVs. Now to generate more IVs, attacker can do what, it can run the replay attack. So this terminal it will keep running and will open the other terminal, and then we try to run the replay attack. And on this other terminal, this one is still running. On the other terminal, attacker will try to run a replay attack. And under the replay attack, we have different multiple attacks. So it will try this three attack. Number three, this is for generating the ARP request. So it will try to send lots of ARP requests with the help of different client IP, client MAC address, and try to generate the traffic. And when the traffic is generated, it will get more IVs. So the command it will run is replay ng number 3. That means it is going to run the number 3 command. Then hyphen B is for the BSSID. And then it will use hyphen H for giving the host SSID. Host SSID, that means it is going to use this host SSID, that means the MAC address, to generate the fake ARP request. Now to get this, we can get it from this other terminal, like where these IVs, these MAC addresses are connected to this. We can see this, that this is the BSSID and these are connected to it. So we can choose one of that. We can choose one of that SSID. One of MAC address. So I will choose one of it. it will be difficult to choose here. After giving the host MAC address, we will mention the interface that is used to do this all attack. That is our WLAN interface. And now I will press enter, and you see now it is sending fake ARP request here. And when we go back, we will see that it is starting the it is generating the data here now, and beacon also, and this one is actually generating very fast. Now this one is getting, now this is actually important beacon on this, and you can see it is now increasing very fast. Why it is generating fast? Because here it is running this ARP attack in this other terminal and sending the ARP request and getting these acknowledgements, and with those acknowledgement the traffic is generated and the IVs are connected, IVs are collected. Now IVs are this. Now what we actually have enough IVs here, but because this is WPA and WPA2 basically, so no matter how many IVs I will collect, it will not work. But if it was WEP connection, and if I have already collected this much IVs, like this much data and beacon, then it will be okay. It will be done and I can crack the password. But it will not work. I just showed you the process. Now I will use ARP attack. And from here, I will stop this one also. So after generating, after collecting enough IVs, we have mentioned the name here. This is the file name where it has all the IVs stored. Now we can check here, and we can see this is the file. Now this is the file is in key, is in the format of cap, dot cap. That means it is a pcap file, so we can open it in Wireshark also. So if we want to detect and we can sniff and we can see the detail, we can check it into the Wireshark also. And also we have a file in CSV format, and also we have a file in Kismet format. This is the other tool which we can use to do attack on this wireless network, Kismet. So it generates the file to support that Kismet tool also, and then the log file also. Now what is important for us to crack the password is this pcap file. So what we'll do next is to just use that file to crack the password. Now we can use aircrack-ng tool now on this file, but because it is not a WEP, so it is not going to crack. Let me show you that. It will directly give me error when I try to use the aircrack-ng on this file. So the next command in the process is to run the aircrack-ng. Aircrack-ng on this file. Now not on CSV, not on Kismet, we have to run it on cap file, dot cap, and just press enter. Now here what it is saying, that I'm not able to detect, I'm not able to crack. Now what it is saying directly, that this one is WPA and this is, it is not possible to do this. It is reading the packet. Please wait, open this, read this much packet, one potential target, but please specify the dictionary file. It is not working here. So it is not working here. There is one target there, but it is a WPA. It is not a WEP. But if it was WEP, then it will just take the 10 seconds to break the password and it will show you the key of that WEP. So this is the process to break the WEP, and it is very easy, and very, very easy. That means we can say it is very easy to break it. This is the process to this cracking WEP. Now next is what? WPA. So how to break this WPA? Now first remember, WPA uses different type of encryption, different type of IVs also, and IVs are not short. It is actually 48 bit IVs. So even if you collect a lots of IVs, not 50,000, if you collect 100,000, 200,000, it will still not be possible to break the WPA encryption. Now what we can do with this WPA encryption if you want to break? So first, WPA PSK, that means pre-shared key. And if the PSK set is there, uses as a user defined password to initialize the TTIP, which is not crackable as it is per packet key, but the key can be brute forced using dictionary attack. So it is not possible to do that, but it is not possible to crack it with the IV, but we can do what? We can do the dictionary attack, brute force or dictionary attack on the authentication key. So you only have to be near the AP for a matter of seconds in order to capture the WPA or WPA authentication handshake. By capturing the right type of packet, you can crack WPA keys offline. Now what that means is the IVs will not work. So what we can do, we can just have to be near, that means near the AP, where we can see, where we can get the packet going from client to the AP, going from victim to AP. So we can capture the authentication handshake. Now authentication handshake, that means when the user, when the client machine or device connect to the AP, they send and receive this authentication handshake. They do the authentication handshake, and with that authentication handshake, they send the encryption key also, they send the password also. So if we can capture that authentication handshake key, then we can go offline. We just don't connect it, we can go home, and then we can do crack, we can do run the cracking method, we can use the dictionary attack to crack or brute force attack to crack it. Now first we have to make sure that we are near to the AP, near to the AP and the victim both who is trying to connect. Now once everyone is connected, then nobody will do the authentication again, nobody will do the authentication and show you the handshake key. So what attacker can do, attacker will use the deauthentication attack. Now attacker do force the connected client to disconnect, then capture the reconnect and authentication packet using tools such as AriPlay. You should be able to re-authenticate in a few seconds, then attempt to dictionary brute force the PMK. Now brute force WPA keys, you can use tools such as AirCrack, AriPlay, KissMack to brute force the WPA keys. Now remember, brute forcing is not sufficient. Brute force is not, we can say, it is not possible to crack. Brute force is, it can break the password 100%, but there is a limitation there. Like if the password is complex and big, then it is very much impossible to do the brute force. So what means basically, dictionary attack will work properly. So what we do for WPA? So for WPA PSK, remember it is PSK, that means pre-shared key. So what we do, we first again run the airmon ng command to convert the monitor mode on our interface, and after starting the monitoring on our interface, we will run the arrow dump command to capture the authentication handshake. We run this and we will wait for any other user to do the authentication. Or what we can do, we can run the deauthentication command. Now we will run the deauthentication attack by AriPlay ng, so that the other users will be disconnected, or disconnected, that means all the users who is connected to the network will be disconnected. And then what, when they reconnect, so our capturing command that was capturing the arrow dump ng, which is capturing the authentication handshake, it will show that WPA handshake is detected. It will show here in this side, it will say that the handshake is detected. Now once it says that handshake is detected, then what, we will go to aircrack ng to run the aircrack ng command to crack on it. Now for that, what we'll use, the dictionary file. So dictionary file, that means first we'll try to use a dictionary, and if it is not successful, then we can go for brute force. Brute force is very difficult, because if the password is big and complex, it will be very difficult to crack. So if it is possible to break from the dictionary, it is good. So what is the process? Now here our interface is already on monitor mode, so we don't have to change it into monitor mode, because it is already on monitor mode, and we can see the name is WLAN 0 mon. So next, what we can do, we can directly start the sniffing. And we can use the same command as what we used previously for WEP. So just like the command we ran on the for WEP, we can run the same command here, but first we run this aerodump ng with the interface name, so that we can get the BSS ID, AESS ID and channel information. Now once we get that, then we can start the sniffing for handshake. Now once we know the information, so to capture the interface, to capture the handshake key, the command is same. The command is same like we use for the WEP. So the command is again aerodump ng and BSS ID. We mentioned the BSS ID, then C for the channel, and then W for mentioning the file name. And then we will mention the interface and then start the sniffing. Now it will be it is now waiting for the authentication to be done. Now if anyone do the authentication, it will show up here the authentication key. But remember, if everyone is connected, then nobody will do the authentication. Now I will not run on this one, I will run on the other one. This one we used it for the we ran this one for the WEP. So I will use the other one. Okay, I will use this one. I will attack on this. This is also WPA, and you can see this is also using PSK, that means pre-shared key. So I will close here, and this time the BSS ID will be this. And the channel also, it is different. So for this network, channel is number 4. So I will do it for channel number 4. And now I will wait for the authentication to be happened. Now you have to wait for the long time to the authentication to be happened, or we can do what, we can run the deauthentication command to disconnect the other users from the network, and then when these users connect back, then we can get the authentication handshake. So for a replay attack, for disconnecting the other users, what we do, we use this replay attack. Now we'll keep this one is running. Now replay attack, when you get help here, you can see the deauthentication attack is this, and also we can say number 0. So we can run either number 0 or we can say hyphen hyphen deauth. So the command will be like this: replay hyphen 0 for deauthentication, and then how much packet you want to send for deauthentication. Let's say I want to send 10 packets of deauthentication. Hyphen A and then we will mention the BSS ID of the router, the AP, and then we can also mention the client MAC address so that it will send the request to the specific client. So whatever the MAC address of the client you will give here, it will send a request to only that client, and that client will be disconnected, and then it will try to connect again and authenticate himself, and the authentication handshake key we will get. Or otherwise you can just send it to all. You can just mention the interface name here, and then it is going to send it to all, and every device will be disconnected. So when you press enter here, it will connect all the disconnect the devices, and then when the devices try to connect, they will get the we can get the authentication handshake. So I'm pressing enter here. Now the client was disconnected when I run that command, and now when the client reconnects, we got the handshake key here, and we can see that this is the handshake key now. Now once we got the handshake key, now we don't have to run it anymore. We can close it now. Control C, and now we can use a command aircrack to do the dictionary attack or even a brute force attack, whatever, to crack the key. Now the point is to crack the key. We have to run the dictionary or brute force attack. Now I will do what? I will try to crack the password because we get the handshake key. So I will try to get the password from the dictionary attack. So for doing the dictionary attack, what I will do? I will use a dictionary file. So first I will use command aircrack, and also it created that file here when you check. So okay, did I change the name? I think I did not change the name. The name is same. Okay, I should have changed the name for this, but okay, it is saying that it is WPCrack 3. Okay, so I'm going to use that file. I should have changed the name because it should be different. Okay, so maybe it is the file. So I am going to run aircrack ng on this file, and I'm going to use the dictionary file. So with the W option, I will use the dictionary file, which is under USR share word list, and not this one, fast track. Okay, so I have a dictionary file there, and this command will do what? It will try to check all the password inside the dictionary file and try to match it with this file which we have captured. Now let's see what happens. And it is got it there. And now we know that key found. Now what it says here, that this is the key for that password. That handshake. So we got the password of WPA also. Now that dictionary file was not that big, so it was found very quickly. Now the point is that the name is under that dictionary file. Now if the name is not in that dictionary, then we will use the other dictionary file, or we use the biggest big dictionary files. We'll try the lots of other dictionary files we have. We can try all those other dictionary files. But if suppose the dictionary file and dictionary attack is not working, then what we can do? We can run the brute force attack. Now remember, brute force attack is very, the chances of getting successful brute forcing is start decreasing when the password is complex and big. So the password, if the password is simple, then it will be easy to crack. But if it is big, the complex and the big password, then it will be very difficult to do the brute forcing. So attacker will try first the dictionary, and it will try big dictionary files, try to get the biggest dictionary available, try to use the dictionary every time. But they don't try to use the brute force because it is very difficult to successful. So this is the password we get. So very simple process. First we have to get the handshake key, and then once we get the handshake key, then we can do the cracking on it and we can get the password. Now this is what WPF PSK. PSK that means pre-shared key. So this is the attack for the pre-shared key. Now we can use the KissMAC. If it is not working dictionary, then you can use the KissMAC also. KissMAC can also do the same thing. It can do the attack. You can crack the brute force WPF and WPA password using this KissMAC. KissMAC runs on Mac OS. Then we have Kane and Abel also. Kane and Abel also, it's a graphical tool which we can use on Windows machine, and we can do the same thing. We can use this to crack the WEP, and also we can use this to crack WPA also. Here we can run the brute force attack also directly if the dictionary attacks are not getting successful. Then we have WPA brute forcing available in this Kane and Abel, where we can do the brute forcing onto Kane and captured file. So if the password is not possible to crack with the dictionary attack, then we can use the brute force attack. We have the other tool, that is LCMSOC Wireless Security Auditor. This wireless security auditor is allow the network administrator to audit an accessibility wireless network. It comes with a built-in wireless network sniffer with air PCAP adapter, and it tests the strength of WPA, WPA2, PSK passwords protecting your wireless network. This is basically auditor. This is basically security auditor software, which tests the security and security of your network. Then we have these other tools which we can use to crack WEP and WPA. Then we have the mobile tools also available, that is Penetrate Pro. Penetrate Pro Android app allows you to decode and access secure Wi-Fi network from Android smartphone and devices. The app calculates WEP, WPA keys for some Wi-Fi routers and lets you to get access by using the password. Penetrate Pro calculates this key for WEP and WPA keys for various wireless routers such as Thomson, Discus, Infinitum, Box, D-Max, Orange, SpeedTalk, D-Link, Aircom, Beacon, O2 wireless routers, etc. Then we have a tool called KissMAC. This is also a sniffer, and this is also do the same thing what we can do with the AirCrack. AirCrack NG. It is an 802.11 layer 2 wireless network detector, sniffer, and intrusion detection system. It identifies the network by passively collecting packet and detecting standard name network. It detects the hidden network and presence of non-beaconing network via data traffic. Then we have these tools for war driving. These are the tools to do the war driving. These are all sniffer. We just run these sniffer on our machine and then start driving through the all area to detect the wireless networks available, open, secure, what kind of security they are having, WEP, WPA, WPA2. Then we have these traffic analyzer tools that we'll use to analyze the network traffic. We can check the strength of the traffic. We can check the what is the capacity and bandwidth of the traffic, and what is the traffic, how much traffic is busy and strength, and how much it is interfering. Then we have these packets, raw packet capturing and spectrum analysis tools to spectrum analyzing and raw capturing packet to check the strength of the wireless network and interference. Then we have these hacking tools for mobile also. This is YHack and Backtrack Simulator. YHack is a program for hacking Wi-Fi which is able to crack WPA, WPA2 and WEP keys. It is for mobile. Then also we have Backtrack Simulator. Backtrack Simulator is simulated with phone Wi-Fi cracker. Phone Wi-Fi cracker can crack WEP, WPA and WPA2 secured wireless networks. Then next we have Bluetooth hacking. Bluetooth is also a wireless network. Now Bluetooth hacking refers to exploitation of Bluetooth stack implementation vulnerabilities to compromise sensitive data in Bluetooth enabled devices and networks. Bluetooth enabled devices connect and communicate wirelessly through ad hoc networks known as PicoNet. So in this we can do this blue smacking, blue bagging. These are the type of attack we have on Bluetooth: blue jacking, blue printing, blue snuffing, blue max spoofing attack, blue sniff, man in the middle impersonation attack. Blue smacking, that means it is a denial of service attack which overflows a Bluetooth enabled device with random packet, causing the device to crash. Blue bugging is remotely accessing the Bluetooth enabled device and using its features. Blue jacking means is the art of sending unsolicited messages over Bluetooth to Bluetooth enabled device such as mobile phones and laptops. Blueprinting, the art of collecting information about Bluetooth enabled devices such as manufacturer, device model and firmware version. Then snuffing, blue snuffing means it is the theft of information from a wireless device through a Bluetooth connection. Max spoofing, that means intercepting the data intended for the other Bluetooth enabled device. Blue sniff means proof of concept code for a Bluetooth war diving utility. It is just an sniffing of Bluetooth network. Then man in the middle impersonation attack means modifying the data between Bluetooth enabled devices communicating in a PicoNet environment. This is the Bluetooth stack. Like we can see the transport protocol here: Bluetooth radio frequency, baseband, link manager and audio. Then hardware compatibility. Then here middleware protocol group, where we have L2 cap, RFCOM, TCS, SDP, OBACS, TCP/IP, ADD, PPP application, which is using this stack. Bluetooth modes are different, like discoverable. Discoverable modes are like this: discoverable, sends inquiry response to all inquiries. Limited discoverable, that means visible for a certain period of time. And non-discoverable, that is never answer an inquiry scan. This is the discoverable mode. And then pairing mode: in pairing mode, non-pairable mode rejects every pairing request, and pairable mode means will pair upon request. So these are the Bluetooth modes: discoverable and pairable mode. Now these are the threats we have in Bluetooth: leaking calendars and address book, remote control. Leaking calendars and address book, that means attacker can steal users' personal information and can use it for malicious purpose, can use it for the social engineering also. Remote control, in this hacker can remotely control a phone to make phone calls or connect to the internet. Then bugging devices, that means attacker could instruct the user to make a phone call to other phones without any user interaction. They could even record the user's conversation. Social engineering, that means attacker trick Bluetooth user to lower security or disable authentication for Bluetooth connection in order to pair with them and steal information. Sending SMS messages, that is like terrorists could send false bomb threats to airline using the phone of legitimate users. Malicious codes, mobile phone worm can exploit a Bluetooth connection to replicate and spread itself, causing financial losses. That means hacker could send many MMS messages with an international user's phone, resulting in a high phone bill. Then protocol vulnerabilities: attackers exploit Bluetooth pairing and communication protocols to steal data, make calls, send messages, conduct denial of service attack on a device, start phone spying, etc. These are the threats of Bluetooth devices we have. Now, how to do the BlueJack a victim? Now, BlueJack is an activity of sending anonymous message over Bluetooth to Bluetooth enabled devices such as laptop, mobile phones via the OBACS protocol. Now, first step one: select an area with the plenty of mobile users, like a cafe or shopping center, etc. Then go to contacts. In your address book, you can delete this contact entry later, but in your address book, what you do, create a new contact on your phone address book. Then enter the message into the name field and like for example, would you like to go on a date with me, like this for example. Then save the new contact with the name text and without the telephone number. Now choose send via Bluetooth. This search for any Bluetooth device within the range. Now choose one phone for the list discovered by the Bluetooth and send the contact. Now you will get the message card sent, and then listen for the SMS message tone of your victim's phone, and that message will receive by the other user. Then we have these Bluetooth hacking tools like BH BlueJack, BT Scanner, CIHW, BT, BT Audit, Blue Art, Blue Alert, Blue Sniff, Bluer, Blue Dive, BT Crawler, Blue Snuffer. These are the tools we have to do the Bluetooth hacking. Now countermeasures, like how to defend against the Bluetooth hacking. So first, use non-regular pattern as pin key while pairing a device. Use those keys combination which are non-sequential on the keypad. Then keep Bluetooth in the disable state, enable it only when needed, and disable immediately after the intended task is completed. Then keep the device in non-discoverable mode, that is hidden. Then do not accept any unknown and unexpected request for pairing your device. Keep a check of all paired devices in the past from time to time and delete any paired device which you are not sure about. Always enable encryption when establishing Bluetooth connection to your PC. Then set the Bluetooth enabled device network range to the lowest and perform pairing only in a secure area. Install antivirus which support host-based security software on Bluetooth-enabled devices. Change the default setting of a Bluetooth-enabled device to best security standard. Use link encryption for all Bluetooth connection. If multiple wireless connection is being used, make sure that encryption is empowered on each link in the communication chain. It is not only talking about the mobile devices. We have multiple devices which connect through the Bluetooth. Like we have the printers also, we have the wireless, we have the, we can say the security cameras are also there which use the Bluetooth connection. Then how to detect and block the raw AP. So first, detecting the raw AP, scan the radio frequency. Radio frequency scanning. It is reproposed access point that do only packet capturing and analysis. So radio frequency sensors are plugged in all over the wired network to detect and warn the WLAN administrator about any wireless devices operating in the area. Then AP scanning, access point that have the functionality of detecting neighboring APs operating in the nearby area will expose the data through its MIBs and web interfaces using wired side inputs. So network manager software uses this technique to detect Management software uses this technique to detect the raw AP. This software detects device connected in a LAN and including Telnet, SNMP, CDP, that is Cisco Discovery Protocol, using multiple protocols. So these are the way of detecting the raw AP. Then blocking the raw AP. Now deny wireless service to any client by launching a denial of service attack on the raw AP. Then block the switch port to which AP is connected, or manually locate the AP and pull it physically off the LAN. So if it is connected, then you can remove it from the network. Now this is the wireless security layers. First, wireless signal security, that is radio frequency spectrum security, wireless IDS. Data protection is done by the encryption, which is WPA2 or AES. Connection security, pre-packet authentication, centralized encryption, network protection, strong authentication, device security vulnerabilities and patches. Then end user protection, stateful per user firewall. How to defend against wireless attack? So first, configuration best practices is to change the default SSID after WLAN configuration. Then set the router access password and enable firewall protection and disable the SSID broadcast. So first, change the default SSID and then disable it also. disable the broadcast also, disable remote router login and wireless administration. That means remotely from the network, wireless network, nobody can log in or through the administrator account. If you want to log into administrator account on the wireless device, then you have to log in locally. Then enable MAC address filtering on your access point or router. Now, not only the encryption, not only using the WEP or WPA encryption or password key, you should use two authentication, two way factors of security. Like you should use the MAC filtering also. So it will get two layers of security. Then enable encryption on access point and change passwords often. So always change your password also. SSID setting best practices are to use the SSID clocking to keep certain default wireless messages from broadcasting the ID to everyone. So it will not broadcast the SSID to with every packet. Do not use your SSID company name, network name or any easy to guess string in passwords. Then place a firewall or packet filter in between the AP and the corporate internet. Then limit the strength of the wireless network so it cannot be detected outside the bounds of your organization. Like whatever the boundary of your organization building is, the wireless network should not be go outside that. Then check the wireless devices for configuration or setup problems regularly, like whether they are having any configuration problem or misconfigurations. Implement an additional technique for encrypting traffic such as IPsec over wireless. So we can also implement the next security password, next security encryption is IPsec on the network. Then authentication best practices is to choose Wi-Fi protected access WPA instead of WEP. Then place wireless access point in a secured location. Implement WPA to enterprise wherever possible. Remember, the password cracking which we have seen is about the WEP and WPA personal pre-shared key. It is not about WPA enterprise. If you use WPA personal, that is using pre-shared key, it can be cracked by cracking the authentication key, handshake key. Now this authentication handshake, if you are using the big and complex password, then only you can be secure with the WPA cracking. Otherwise, you should use the WPA enterprise version. Now enterprise means what? The centralized authentication will be done. Now in that case, it is difficult for the attacker to capture that handshake key. Then keep drivers on all wireless equipment updated, disable the network when not required, use a centralized server for authentication, that is under the WPA enterprise. So how to defend against wireless attack? So we can use, this is the best practices. Like we can see that this is internet, now coming from internet, use wireless IDSS, firewalls, enable WPA2, and disable the SSID also. And for the outside user, use VPN connection and encryption to connect, like IPsec. Then these users are valid users and connect, and the attacker cannot connect. Then for the authentication, we should use the RDS server, that is centralized authentication, which can also authenticate the Wi-Fi network also. We can use VPN server to connect the remote users. We can use IPsec to secure the VPN connection from the enterprise network. Use IPsec for the internet access. Then wireless intrusion prevention system. Now for wired network, we have intrusion detection system, and for wireless network, we have intrusion prevention system. This do what? It is to detect those kind of attack. This wireless intrusion prevention system protect network against wireless threats and enable administrator to detect and prevent various network attacks. So it do the probing and network discovery, then row identification and containment, and Wi-Fi network monitoring also. And this impersonation detecting and prevention, location tracking, network intrusion detection, it can do all. It can do all these attacks, it can detect all these type of attack. So where the wireless IPS deployment should be? So as you can see in the design, where the internet and the other DMZ zone is connected, so in between we should use this wireless intrusion prevention system through your public Wi-Fi network, through your corporate network, to connected to the public network. Now Wi-Fi security auditing tools are like this Air Magnet Wi-Fi Analyzer. This is just an analyzer. It is a Wi-Fi network auditing and troubleshooting tool. Automatically detects security threats and other wireless network vulnerabilities. It detects Wi-Fi attacks such as denial of service attack, authentication, encryption attack, network penetration attack. It can locate unauthorized raw devices or any policy violator. Then we have Motorola's Air Defense Service Platform ADSP. This also do detect all those type of attack. It is also for the defense of our wireless network. Then we have adaptive wireless IPS. This is the IPS software. This is adaptive wireless IPS. WIPS provides wireless network threat detection and mitigation against malicious attacks and security vulnerabilities. It provides the ability to detect, analyze and identify wireless threats. Then we have Aruba RF Protect, that is integrated wireless intrusion detection and prevention. This is automatic threat mitigation for centrally evaluating forensic data and actively containing raws and locking down device configurations. Automated compliance reporting to meet policy mandates for PCI and these denial of service and GLB with automated report distribution that is tailored to specific audit requirement. Now these tools are not free. So many tools of these are not free. Then there are some other tools also available. Not all of them are free, but some of them are free or can say open source to work. These are intrusion prevention systems. Then we have these predictive planning tools also to plan our wireless network security and reach and interference. Then we have the vulnerability scanning tools also. That like the ZenMap is also it is a graphical version of NMap. So just like that, we have these other tools which we can use to do the scan the vulnerability, like this NSS also. Then we have the Bluetooth security tool, which is Bluetooth firewall. This Fruit Mobile Bluetooth firewall protects your Android device against all sort of Bluetooth attacks from device around you, and it display alert when Bluetooth activities take place, and you can also scan your device and detect apps with Bluetooth capabilities also. Then we have Wi-Fi security tools for mobiles, that is Wi-Fi Protector, Wi-Fi Guard, Wi-Fi Inspector. These are for also mobile. Now for doing the penetration testing. Now the process of actively evaluating information security measures implemented in a wireless network to analyze design weakness, technique flaws and vulnerability, and a comprehensive report in detail about the finding along with the suite of recommended countermeasures is delivered to executive management and technical audience. This is the task of penetration testing of wireless. It is a task to thread the assessment, security control, auditing, upgrading the infrastructure, data theft detection, risk prevention and response, and information system management. So for penetration framework, we'll start with the discovering of devices, then wireless devices found or not found. If it is not found, then again go for discovery, and if it is found, then document all the findings, what devices we can found. Then go for wireless network, whether it is there or not. If it is not there, again go for the discovery, and then if it is there, then we will check that using WEP encryption or not. We'll do perform the general Wi-Fi network attack to see whether it is using WEP encryption. Now, if it is using WEP, then perform the penetration testing for WEP. If it is not, then go for checking, is it using WPA, WPA2 encryption. If it is yes, then next, or if it is using the other encryption, if it is not using WPA or WPA2, then uses the LEEP encryption. And if it is using, then go for the next step. And if it is not, then unencrypted WLAN. Now if it is unencrypted, yes, then it goes to the next step, or otherwise go for the normal attacks. Now what is next? So these are the general Wi-Fi attack. Create a raw access point, de-auth the clients, and then associate the client to the fake UP, and then sniff the traffic, acquire the password certificates, and if it is not passing, then go for again to deauth client. And if they successfully do that, then what? Crack the passwords, steal the confidential information, and use these kind of tools. Now, if you are having leap encryption on WLAN, leap that means leap encryption. It is using leap encryption. Now, this is actually a Cisco implementation of this authentication. It is a Cisco proprietary actually of that enterprise version of WPA2. So if it is there, again try to do the deauthentication client, and if it is not successful, then again try to leave the check the encryption. Now if it is successfully, then break the leap encryption, steal the confidential information. Then for WPA and WPA2 encryption, what we'll do, we'll try to do the deauthentication client, then when try to use the client, try to connect again, we'll sniff the traffic and capture the authentication handshake. And if it is not captured, then go again and deauthenticate. If it is captured, then perform dictionary attack and use the tools such as these, AirCrack, NG and all. And if it is successfully cracked, then you can connect and steal the information. For WEP attack, just check the visible SSID, sniff the traffic, capture and inject the packet, and try to get the WEP, try to break the WEP. Now for that, if it is not visible, then try to deauth the clients and check whether it is the closed SSID. So check the associated and then sniff the traffic to see the SSID. Once you get it, then try to break it and use the tools like these AirCrack NG to launch the replay attack. And if it is unencrypted, then what? Unencrypted, that means it is visible or not SSID. If it is not visible, do the deauthentication for the client. When the clients do the association, we can see the SSID. And then what? If it is a MAC address, filtering is there or not? Now sometime it is open, but sometime it is only having MAC address filtering. So if it is there, then connect the AP using the IP within the discovered range, like the allowed MAC addresses. Or if it is not there, then start spoofing the MAC addresses and use these tools and steal the information, because there is no information, there is no security. So this is the topic, this is the way we have the wireless hacking. So we can do wireless hacking by just, wireless is not secure for from the sniffing. Like a attacker can sniff everything if it is not encrypted. And if it is encrypted, that means if it is using this WEP encryption or encryption with the WEP, so it is very weak and it can be cracked very quickly. And if it is using WPA, so WPA encryption key, WPA or even WPA2 personal, that is using the pre-shared key. So if it is using the WPA personal pre-shared key, then again it can be cracked easily. But you have to capture the authentication handshake key. Now, if the handshake key we captured, but the password is very big in number, like it is more than 8 character and complex, then it is very difficult to break. But if it is a small and dictionary word, then we can easily crack into it. So this is wireless hacking, or hacking wireless networks.